Sensational. You know, at this sort of time of the day, you do start to get that, you know, post-lunch funk, where you start that, oh, sugar levels are all going like this and you feel like having a little nap. But I guarantee you that that will not happen when Ian starts to talk. You see, the good thing I like about Ian is he is really, he's really kind of energetic and passionate in the way that he communicates. So it's really quite captivating. So it'll actually be good for you. Ian's actually has quite a diverse thing, and he's talking around the circle of life, which is really trying to consider his life experiences, family and all the rest of it, plus his experiences as a developer, businessman, entrepreneur and all those sorts of things. And he's really going to present something which actually, in fairness, may actually contradict a little bit of what's been said this morning. But where those contradictions lie actually creates a lot of opportunity. So I'd love you to welcome Ian Ugarte, and it's great to have you again, Ian. Thank you.
So I'm just a really exciting speaker, and firstly, I do want to acknowledge the land and where we're meeting today, to pay my respect to elders past and present, and to welcome anyone from any culture, anywhere that's Indigenous. And, you know, that includes the Americas, the Europeans and everyone. So the reason I start always with that welcome to country is because community is a massive focus of what I do now and not previously what I did. And what we do now at Small Is a New Big is we create genuine community connection, and the way we do that is by providing housing that has some elegant makeup to it, that's adaptable and allows the movement to be able to have someone move into something at the age of 18 or 19, grow their family, and then what we call uplife. Unfortunately, people call it downsizing, we call it uplifing, back to a point where they're in the same style of property again, and that's what we call our circle of life. Now, I'm not an advocate, I'm an advocate and actual maker. You know, it's great in theory for us to be able to talk about what's possible out there. I talk about what's possible out there and I actually go out and do it as well. And do I learn a lot from it? Yeah. Do I make massive mistakes? Yeah. Do I have better outcomes for the next project? Absolutely. So what we talk about and what I always start talking about is that feeling of the despair, insecurity and fear that Australians have in general around many areas of the life, but particularly around housing. When we've got Hong Kong being the most unaffordable housing in the world, where do you reckon the second most unaffordable city in the world is? Hobart is the second most unaffordable housing city in the world when you look at housing versus the wages that they earn, followed by Sydney, followed by Melbourne. In the top eight capital cities in Australia, they make the top 53 in the world. In the top 20 most unaffordable cities in the world, Australia has 13 of them, with Sunshine Coast at number 8. So when we talk about having to live that despair, insecurity and fear, usually it revolves around three particular things. It's not having enough money, and in some cases having too much money. You're being tied to a job, just over broke, and for those people that want to become a socialist, as soon as you start working, you're in a capitalist system. So I now call myself the socialist capitalist, which is like mixing a cat and a dog. And the reason that came about was because I felt those emotions. I went out to become the richest man in the world, and I was going to be the biggest property developer that you could ever imagine. I went ahead and had done that, moved up to the Sunshine Coast, and we would go down to Sydney to visit our family. So it was just my wife and my daughters up here, and so I'd go down to visit grandparents, uncles and aunties. I went down there after leaving work, after becoming a full-time developer, after producing stuff like, you'll have to excuse me if I upset you, but the city of colour is the city of brown and grey. There is so much crap out there. It's a city of septic tanks, seriously. Harmony, you drive past Aussie World and you see the scourge hitting the freeway. Those four-bedroom, two-bathroom houses were the sort of stuff that I was putting to the marketplace, and I thought I was doing the right thing and I was becoming richer. And I woke up in Sydney one morning, the day we were driving back after visiting a family, suicidal. And for 30-odd years of my life, I'd chased money to the point where I actually woke up one day with money in my bank account and completely hollow and nothing in me, just absolutely distraught. So we drove back, and my plan was to get my family back to their house on the Sunshine Coast, and the following day I was ending my life. At Pottsville, we stopped to have a Skype meeting with a really dear friend of mine, and we asked the girls to get out and just play in the park, and I'm sitting in the car. I hadn't spoken a word all day, and thankfully for whatever sentence happened and came out of my mouth, I was saved that day by Christine, my wife, who you see up there, and Michelle, and they dragged me out of that really crappy hole. I often say I'm really, really grateful for the worst day of my life, because without that happening, there's just no in the way in the world that I'd do what I do on a daily basis every day and have the fulfillment of what I do with community, not for community, with community. And as an outcome, my dollar payoff that I used to be looking for is not the payoff I look for anymore. Now, money does give you freedom and choice, but it certainly didn't make me happy. So as we worked along, we realised that the multi-generational house was probably a good trade. You know, if I'm an Australian born of Spanish heritage, and had my parents stayed in Spain and I was born in Spain, we would end up in a position where I would have lived with my grandparents, and then my grandparents would have died, I would have had kids, and there would have been three generations. If you've ever wondered, well, we talk about needing to fulfill the single and double households in this country, and I'll talk about this as we go through, but essentially from baby boomers all the way down to Gen Ys, and if you've ever wondered why they call Gen Ys, there you have it, right? And hipsters, because they don't have anywhere else to wear their pants, they wear them around here. So we have a shortage. We've got so much stuff, and we've assisted quite a few families to up life, to go from these large houses down. And you can't go from a three-bedroom, four-bedroom house to a tiny. There has to be a step process to do that. We talk about councils and councils having to meet the need and priority. Now, remember, I often hear, and I think I heard on the panel before, that we're just going to go out and do it and see what we deal with afterwards. Unfortunately, that style of approach when it comes to councils, governments and bureaucrats is that you could be damaging your industry. So if you can't have a tiny house and you go and put a tiny house somewhere and then a council complaint comes in and the compliance officer comes in, you have now flipped that compliance officer from someone who could try to work with you to someone who's not wanting to work with you or the industry, and then we've got a bad name. Now let's face it, a tiny house is a caravan that if I put it on a block of land, other than a trailer park and a caravan park, I have to meet the National Construction Code, in which case, now that it's in the National Construction Code, when I go and build it to the construction code, it's too heavy to tow on the road. So we have to come up with a happy medium where everyone is happy. Council's number one priority is not really to look after the people inside their jurisdiction, it's to make sure they don't get sued. That's plain and simple. Number two, they pretend to look after the people that live within their jurisdiction. We talk about affordable versus desirable. When it comes to affordability, it's not low socio. Affordability depends on where you want to live. The definition of, by the federal government is spending no more than 30% of your gross wage on rental accommodation. So essentially, if you earn $1,000 a week and you take a tax off that, there's $750 to $800. You earn $1,000, you spend more than $300, you're under housing stress. And when you see some of the graphs that I've got here, you'll start to realise that there's probably about 90% of the people that are renting are under housing stress, which means they'll never save money for their own home. And then I'll talk about the circle life as we go through. This was me, I was speaking on a stage, speaking at a homelessness conference, keynote speaking about how the mum and dad investors of Australia can actually fix the housing market without being greedy and without by producing the right style of product. I got on a plane, flew home and walked into a 400 square metre four-storey home, completely incongruent with what I talk about. Now, I should have got the memo that the reason I was born small was so I could think small, and that certainly wasn't small. So we uplifed to a property where we moved into a house which was the same size house as the average Australian house in 1960. We moved in there, and you might think, big deal, like I've seen you, Christine's not 6 foot tall either, you don't need that much space, but we moved into that two bedroom, one bathroom home with four daughters, one of them a teenager. And at the time, being a plumber and builder, I could have put a new toilet in that property within 3 hours, it was that easy to do. But I didn't do it because I noticed in that house that we operated differently than the big house. We started to interact with each other, we argued more. We also got to a point where if they didn't want to sort it out with me, we were in a position where my kids didn't want to talk to me, they have to go outside. There's nowhere else to go, which was awesome. Then we upsized even further to 72 square metres. Six of us, 12 square metres each was basically what we had in that house. And we're currently building a new house at the moment, which is a modified earthship that's built into the hill. You know, I often talk about the size of houses, and this slide shows the amount of people in houses from 1881 to through to 2011. 1881, the average size Australian house was 35 square metres. In that house was 5.5 people. 1960, we have a two-bedroom, one-bathroom house, which is 85 square metres, and the top of that house that we used to live in was the same size as the Australian house in 1960, most of them built by a guy called L.J. Hooker before he became a real estate agent. In that house, there was 3.8 people. In 2011, Australians win the gold medal, the world gold medal for the largest houses in the world. We build a 246 square metres average size. Every one of those houses is a four-bedroom, two-bathroom house. We have 25 million Australians. And tonight, when we go to bed, there's 12 million empty bedrooms in this country. We've got 116,000 homeless people, of which 50,000 of them you can't actually tell are homeless. They're sleeping in cars, couch surfing, and they still work, they still dress beautifully, they still go to restaurants. You just can't tell they've got nowhere to sleep. And this is a big problem in this country. So if I asked you the question, if I took my Australian builders and I went over to Hong Kong and I said, build me an Australian house in Hong Kong, don't answer this question if you've heard me speak before. How many Hong Kong houses can I fit in one Australian house? Take a guess. Six? 10? Try 22.6 Hong Kong houses in one average size Australian house. And if each one of those houses had 2.5 people, I would open the front door of the Australian house in Hong Kong and there'd be 56.5 people living in that house. That's called community. So then we say, well, what part of the house do we actually use? So here we've got a study that was done. They followed 36 families around for 4 years. What parts of the house did they use? The informal dining room, the family room, and the kitchen. Then upstairs, you've got these bedrooms. So let's think about this. We're building these massive bedrooms with an ensuite, which I think Mr. Jennings and Mr. Marston built their ensuite, were the first people in Australia to have ensuites. Maybe they were a bit worried and jealous that they were going to lose their wife, so they needed somewhere to mark their territory close to their wife. That's a joke, by the way. You don't have to laugh. It's okay. But why build these massive bedrooms when we spend 8 hours a night, one-third of our life, lying on our back unconscious? It doesn't make any sense to build larger size homes. This is the only place you don't want to see the Maroons be showing up in there. This is the vulnerability index in Queensland, and you can see when it's flickering in and out, the Maroon section, most of that is the Sunshine Coast. Most of that area is the area that says that we're struggling. And so when you look at this slide here, just to explain it to you, if you see red or pink, then, and I have permission to use this slide, red or pink, 50% of the 70-year-olds that are living in these areas are living in less than $399 per week when the minimum rent is $300. And down in the bottom areas where you see the dark red, 75% of the 70-year-olds are living on less than $399 a week. That means that they pay their rent, and then their choice is, do I pay for utilities or do I pay for food? Heat or eat, that's their choice. And so where are we in this country, the lucky country, where we've got people that have worked 50-plus years of their life to get to the point where they should be enjoying themselves, and yet they can't afford to leave work and they're still working because they have no choice? And we've got choice, we've got the ability to make a difference. This is a Sunshine Coast study, and what I want you to see is these two numbers here joined with this number here. So we got 50%, we got 60 plus percent of the people on the Sunshine Coast are single or double households. So that is one person or a household that's got a couple in it, that's got siblings in it, that's got two friends in it, that's got a single parent with a single child. And when you look at it, the number of houses that are 3, 4, and 5-bedroom houses are 70%. So we've got nearly 70% of our market only needs a small place, and 70% of our market essentially is in a place where it's not quite right. And so to add to that, the Sunshine Coast, this is the change of the new people that came to the Sunshine Coast in the 5 years from 2011 to 2016. And if you look at it, the majority of people that turned up on the Sunshine Coast are singles and couples, and the majority of houses are 4, 5 and plus bedrooms. What are we doing? Why are people, developers like the old me, building this sort of stuff? Why? Because they think the couples like living in these spaces, and they don't. They just don't have the choice. That's what it comes down to. Metropolitan study done by the Department of Health and Human Services showed that in the metro area, the median price for a four-bedroom house, if you're renting it, is $420, and the median price for a two-bedroom house is $415. There's $5 difference between renting a two-bedroom and a four-bedroom. Why? Because people want two bedders. Queensland Housing Minister said that you can't build a home for $20,000. I said, don't challenge me. So for $18,569, I bought a triaxle caravan, very well strong made. I wouldn't do it with a modern caravan because they'd fall to bits. We didn't take any of the internal cupboards out, because you take the internal cupboards out, you're in trouble. So not including labour, it cost us $18,569 to build a home, which is a tiny, which is a dog to tow, and I hate towing it, but it sleeps seven people. This is what it looked like as we went through the build as a time lapse. And this thing here was, again, I just called on all friends to come around and give us a help in the community. Small as New Big is our company name. And we built it. The roof style itself, the actual shape, was due to the fact that we bought 90% of the stuff we bought was either ex-stock, end-of-line, reused or recycled material. The cladding on the outside of that cost $200. And so with this, working, you know, some nights and days, as you can see there, we ended up doing this within 22 days. We towed it down to Brisbane and we released it at a affordable housing conference down there, which was pretty awesome. Do we sell them? No. Do I think tiny houses are the answer to the affordability problem? No, I don't. I think it's a small component of the answer, because people generally can't live in 28 square metres, especially when you've got children. So, you know, it's something that we love doing. So if you want to find, if you want to see the finished product, it's a longish video, 15 minutes, just go onto YouTube and just put in there Veruca Salt Tiny House. We called it Veruca Salt because the Gen Ys of the world, and I don't know if you know who Veruca Salt is, she was in Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory, and I want it now, Daddy. That's Veruca Salt, right? So you want it now? Good, you've got it. $18,569. Stop complaining that you can't buy a four-bedroom house as a 20-year-old. Start like we all did, small and build up from that. There are some tiny house approvals that have happened across the country, but what they've done is they've used different approval processes. This one here in New South Wales used the New Generation Boarding House approval to get four individual tiny houses built on the land, strapped down to the land so they don't blow over in the wind, and a nice little project. It is for homeless, that one though. We've been building these for the last 20 years. You may know at the end of Mary Street, if you turn right at Red Rooster and you go to the boat ramp, sitting down there is our first prototype, which is that bottom boat. It's been repainted since then. We've also got Bryce coming up talking after me, and he did a whole show on just that tiny house. It's called Life on the Water in a Tiny Houseboat, and you'll get to see what that is. It's about 60 square metres. It sleeps six people, and the reason I built these was because I was sick of seeing ugly houseboats, so we build some decent houseboats now. I like this South American architect. His name's Alejandro Arena, and he designs houses for people so they can grow into their houses. So it doesn't cost as much to build a big house, so let's build half the house. And I know this is Australia, and you'll probably think that this is not great looking, but they buy the half house, and as their family grows and as they have the enough money, they then put themselves in a position to be able to grow the house. This is another form, which is a portal building with a veranda and a car spot, and then after time, as the family grows and they can afford it, they grow into that house, and like we all did in Australia. Now, previously someone talked about co-living developments. As a property investor, this is what I do. I build co-living communal housing. Housing that allows people to be able to live together, and if they want their own space, they have their own space. They've got their own bathroom, they've got their own kitchenette, they've got their own sitting area, and they've got their own bedroom. And when they want to come out and share space with other people, they can do that. So I'm not sure why it's flickering, I'm sorry about that. We talked about ageing and ageing in place. So with me, when we talk about ageing in place, I'm very, very conscious of the fact that we have a huge amount of people that are retirees that have a huge asset base but low cash flow. And the issue is that they don't want to downsize. They don't want to move away from their family. They don't want to move away from their friends. They don't want to move away from the shopping centre, and they don't want to leave their house. So what we say to them is, there's policies already across the country. Thankfully, there's been some change in the draft plan, which allows a lot more to be happening in Noosa in the next little while once that draft comes through. But what we do is we talk to the older retirees and we say, well, you only use 3 rooms of your house. Let's create a component of your house where you can live comfortably. You'll have your own yard space. You'll have your own entry. And then they say, yeah, but I don't want to live with people. Well, you're not really. You're simply living in a smaller space because that's what you're going to have to do anyway. Let's create something more out of the bigger house you've got so that you've got some rental income coming in. But then I'm going to lose my pension. Don't worry, it's double the amount of your normal pension, right? My mother, she's fairly wealthy. She's dead set that she's getting the pension, right? And I'm saying, Mum, there's no chance you're getting the pension. Like, I paid my taxes for so long. I say, Mum, why do you want the pension? So I can go to the movies half price. Okay. Mum, just go on Tuesdays or Monday or whatever it is. But then I can't get on the bus half price. I say, Mum, you've never been on a bus in your life, so let's get on, right? Just forget, you're not getting a pension, right? But we came up with this model. This is a model that we can build in Brisbane today, and we don't even have to go to council to get the approval. The model here says that let's get 5 asset-rich retirees that are single, they've either divorced or they've lost their partner, and they're sitting on a $500,000 asset base. So they have a committee, they create a unit trust, and they decide, they each visit each other's houses, and then they vote, which one are we going to keep out of the 5? Now, we all know that voting by committee is very dangerous, so you can't vote for your own property. And so what happens is they end up with one of the properties, and they sell 4 of them, which means they've got $2 million sitting in a bank account. They build this house, which can be built right now in Brisbane. It's got a formal dining area coming in here. Come on. It's not going to play with me now. You've got a formal dining area. It's coming, I promise. Formal dining area that we move into. Where everyone communes if they want to, but you can notice bedroom 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 have their own kitchenette, they have their own ensuite, they've got their own courtyard where they can have the little dog, and there's disability bathrooms in that property as well. So now, for $500,000 we built this. We had the $500,000 original home plus the $500,000 that came out of the kitty, which means there's $1.5 million sitting in a bank account, spread amongst 5 people, which means they've each got $300,000. They're now sitting in an area where they've got people to comfort them, to look after them. If something goes wrong, if they haven't come out the door for a day, there's people knocking on the door, and this is what we call community. And if you're a young Gen Y and you've got $40,000 and you can hook up with 5 other people, we can show you how to do exactly the same thing and get into a property that'll cost you $50 a week to live in, which, if that's what you want to do, I think that's a pretty good outcome. And they say that you can't do this. We're doing it already, and we're showing people how to do it all over the country. This is called the 60-30 model. It's actually a hybrid of Malcolm's model. This is a model that says, if I'm a young couple and I do want to buy a house, we'll build a 90-square-metre house, not a 200-square-metre house, which means the young couple can live in the 30-square-metre area, and in that 30-square-metre area, they can also double up during the day so that their bedroom has a fold-up bed. You pull it up into the wall, it folds away, and a desk appears, so they can be an accountant or they can be a bookkeeper or something during the day. They've got their waiting room, and at night time their waiting room becomes their lounge room, and again their bedroom becomes their bedroom. In the other side, we've got a 2-bedroom, 2-bathroom, retractable walled living room, which means that at night time, if you need more space and you need another bedroom to sleep, well, you've got a sofa that appears, fold the bed down, the sofa disappears, and during the day you fold it up again. So that young couple can have a child, move into the other side, still rent. At every point in time, they're paying down their debt. Who in here has a 20 or 30-year-old still living at home? Guess what? They're not there because they like you. Maybe they do. But they are certainly there because of the affordability component to not having to move out. So I would talk about more is less. And so this is our circle of life model. And We've done this in smaller scale developments, but what we're doing at the moment is a larger scale development that incorporates the entirety. And we're not pioneers, by the way. We simply do what people are doing all over the world. And, you know, so I don't take any credit for what we do. I simply just go, that looks like it's going to work. I'm going to have a crack at it and see how it goes. So the circle life model is the 18 or 19-year-old or the 20 to 30-year-old that's still living at home. They move into a communal residence. That is something that has their own space, but they share some space as well. They go off and they meet a partner. Between the two of them, they're now saving some money. So within 3 to 5 years, they've got enough money for a deposit to buy into a 60-30 home. And that 60-30 home, they live in the smaller space and they rent the larger space out and they get some income coming in, which means they pay down the debt. They have a child, so they then create, they move into one area and then the smaller area gets rented out, again, paying down their debt. By the time they have their second child, they can add to this building or they could refinance, go and buy another building, which is slightly bigger. Then they go have a third child. And if they're crazy like me, they go off and have four daughters and they have the large four-bedroom home. But that four-bedroom home is built in a particular way so that it's adaptable into the future as well. Now, by the time that they have that fourth child, the first child that was born now starts their own circle of life, which means, yes, the child's out, we can now start to up life. So they come down, and again, the next child moves into their own circle of life, they come down again, and the next child comes down into that point. Now, at that point in time, they've not had any despair, insecurity, and fear because at every point in time in their early years, they were getting money coming in to pay the debt. They weren't being greedy, they were just saying, here's somewhere to stay, would you like to pay some rent? It's going to help me pay my debt off. While the person staying in there can save some money as well. At that point in life, at the opposite end of their life, they've now, on their own, couple, they've got a caravan parked in the driveway, and from that they can go off every 3 months while they're renting out a 60 square metre component of the building, and they're not concerned about finances and not concerned about cash flow because they've got cash flow coming in. This is the face of homelessness. 3 years ago, we had Rebecca come into our life. We put an ad up in Gumtree and said we're looking for adopted grandmother, Mary Poppins. She came along, and as already indicated, the biggest growing demographic of homelessness in this country is women aged over the age of 50 or 55, and the next lot is the parents of people with a disability. The new NDIS is going to throw parents out on the road. And Rebecca, you could not tell, was homeless. She was vulnerable in a position. She'd lost her business in the GFC, a mother with dementia. So she's now saved her money, paid off all the debts, about to get into her first property, fingers crossed. And this is unfortunately what the face of homelessness is, and we can't see that anymore. So we're buying a showground, and this race course has been built around by the city. In here, we've got a full master plan. We have industrial homes. So that is a large shed at the back of the home, and sitting above that is a three-bedroom house so that the mechanic that works many, many hours can have his kids and his family around him. We've got a retirement village, a nursing home with a childcare centre in between in the same building. And that childcare centre has to visit the retirement village and the nursing home twice a week. So that's four times a week of visits. The people we're working with there can measure increased happiness, increased longevity of life, decrease in depression, and decrease of pharmaceuticals. We then have another area of the property of the buildings that have a four-bedroom house, but it's made up of a micro-apartment, a one-bedroom, and a two-bedroom. So it's four bedrooms overall. Young couple moves in there, has one child, has two children, has three children, has four children, and then they do the same and start renting out parts of the property as they go. My favourite part of this build, of this development, is the two-bedroom, one-bathroom property, which is made up of a 25-year-old, under 25, one over 65 and the other. And in that makeup, we've got the 25-year-old every time that they go to breakfast, go shopping, go for a walk, go to the movies with a 65-year-old. They get on our website, they log it, and then the 65-year-old says, yes, we're happy that that happened, and we reduce the 25-year-old's rent by $5 a week as an incentive for someone who's good at computers and can't communicate to talk to someone who can communicate and is not great at computers. So we've got an intermingling of demographic. So, and this is another one of our properties here. This one we run neutral. It's 12 people that live in 12 separate one-bedroom villas. We have 9 of them paying $20 under market rent every week, so it means $1,000 in their pocket every year and not in my pocket. And then we've got a 65-year-old, an 83-year-old, and a 92-year-old that have lifelong tenure, not allowed to kick them out. I can't kick them out. It's in their contract until they go to a nursing home or they pass away. And they pay $60 for the rest of their life, guaranteed. And that's what I do on a daily basis. Now, this is not an ego slide. This is simply saying that what I was before and what I am now are two different people. I like this one here. It's just a short video.
Gedaan door het heel simpel te houden, ik wil het warmste en meest gezellige huis van Deventer zijn. Dat kunnen we niet doen met extra personeel, want iedereen weet dat het met minder geld moet. Dus dan kan ik meer geld gaan uitgeven, dan is het niet duurzaam. Dus toen dacht ik eerst aan een verbinding met het onderwijs, voor studiepunten of voor wat dan ook.
Wat ik wel heel grappig vind is dat er zijn toch heel veel vrouwen die hier wonen. En die houden af en toe nog wel van een flirt met een jonge jongen. En dan loop je langs of er wordt even gefloten of je krijgt een knipoog. En dus, je krijgt een klap onder je billen. Dat vinden ze allemaal wel...
Ik denk dat de studenten het algemene sfeer van de gesprekken beïnvloeden. Dus dat het niet meer gaat over dood of over ziekte, ongemak van het oude leven. Maar het gaat over jeugd, het gaat over de feesten, het gaat over de vriendinnen.
Ja, het is eigenlijk heel typisch, want je hebt zeg maar een bejaarde tehuis en mensen denken van dat is oud en stoffig. Maar volgens mij is het gewoon een middelbare school. En als je aan tafel zit of je hebt tijdens het eten, dan heb je verschillende tafeltjes natuurlijk. Dus deze is de nerdy table en deze is de mooie meidentafel. En dit is dan de voetbaltafel met allemaal stoere jongens. En dat zijn dan de groep die horen er dan helemaal niet bij of wat dan ook. Wat wel in mijn hoofd blijft kleven was het feit dat ik een buurvrouw had van 104, die uiteindelijk 105 is geworden, wat ik nog mee heb gemaakt. En die uiteindelijk, toen ik bij haar in de kamer kwam, mij in één keer plotseling een hand gaf, ze lag op bed, en mij een goed leven verder wenste. En dat ik het beste ervan moest maken, met het idee van dat ze echt afscheid aan het nemen was. En dat klopte ook, want en enkele dagen daarna was ze ook overleden. En dat blijft even wel bij je zitten. Vooral omdat ik niet de gedachte had dat ik bijvoorbeeld nog even dat laatste geluk eruit kan persen met die mensen.
So like I said, we're not pioneers, we're simply doing what's happening around the world. And so rich people have a lot of money, wealthy people have time to spend it. Our catchphrase in our business now is it needs to make sense before it makes dollars. So that is, it needs to affect the community in a positive way first. Secondly, it needs to make money. We can all go out and do property deals and go broke. So we do the both. It has to do both of them as well. I'm not sure if we're open for questions, but I'm happy to take them.
Yeah. You can have questions for sure, Ian, because I bet you there is some.
So, hey,
and this is how Ian goes. If you got a question, he's going to throw a book at your head. Is that, no.
So there's no questions?
No. So if you've got a question, if you'd mind coming to the microphone so everybody can hear it, just give us your name and That'd be great. And if, yeah, again, just try to make it a question, not a big, long statement, please.
Hey, my name's Danny Campbell. So I just want to confirm, so all those developments, is therefore you are a profitable business, you're not a non-profit?
Correct, that's I'm a profitable business, yep.
Okay.
But most of those profits go back into what we do. I live a fairly simple life. I'm not over the top. I don't have expensive cars, and I live well. But you know, I make sure that the people that are living in our development save 1/3 to 1/2 off their normal weekly rent, which means that they save money within 3 to 5 years. They're not living unaffordably. They can save money to buy their own house. We're taking the pressure off the bottom of the. When we've got 80%, up to 80% of the people needing smaller homes, and 80% of the homes in Australia being 3, 4, and 5 bedroom houses, we've got a massive problem. And so what we do is we create the homes that people need, because the commodity of property needs to be stopped. My ultimate game is in the next 10 years, where we're 1 million self-contained homes short, is to oversupply the marketplace. And in every oversupply of a marketplace, it's crashed the marketplace. So I'm a developer trying to smash my own marketplace.
So with saying that, though, wouldn't that change the... When you're talking about, like, getting 5 elderly people, they go in, they sell the home, and so therefore all those money therefore goes into an account, and obviously a trust-bearing account, and then is that then paid out in dividends, which is helping the people?
No, they'll each individually have $300,000 sitting in their own personal account.
In their own personal account, so yep. It's not done in a trust?
No, it's so the unit trust owns the property with the 5 of them as unit holders, and yep. They each individually have their $300,000, which are all capital gains free.
Great, and so does that then take away from, so if, say if they pass away, then you're just selling that living trust or unit trust, so therefore you don't continually pay stamp duty on the transactions?
So this is not any advice here, I'm not a financial planner, but any change in a property that's less than 20% has no capital gain or stamp duty. So capital gain possibly, stamp duty not.
Stamp duty not. Thank you.
Thank you. Come on, that's $25 you'll get paid for one question.
Should I have one more question?
You're not getting 2 books.
I know, I don't want 2 books, so thank you. My other question, you mentioned Hobart, only I am an investor in Tassie. And so did you...
Where in Tassie?
In Hobart and Launceston.
Yep.
So did your organisation get in on, because obviously the Tasmanian government currently
I'm a government advisor to 4 different governments, one of them being the state government in Tasmania.
Yep. Did you take advantage of when they're actually now paying investors or people with the property $12,500
So as an advisor, they put that policy in front of me and I had to tell them that you've broken 3 other policies, so you need to change this. Overall, that policy is not a great policy, and it's only limited to 240 houses. That's not enough.
No.
But there is a new policy coming out in Tasmania that'll fix the housing problem. It'll take 1/3 off the housing waiting list that shouldn't be there. It'll do that within 3 years.
So should I sell things now?
No. Absolutely not.
All right, thank you.
Have you got any on the sunny coast, any of these communities? Yes, you do.
Oh. There's one with 12 micro apartments on the Sunshine Coast where the average stay there is about 1 year, 12 months. Each one of them has their own bedroom and their own bathroom. 4 of them have their own kitchenette as well. 4 of them have their own courtyard as well. In there, they live quite happily. Rebecca actually lives in one of those. You cheated, so you're not getting a book.
I've got
your book. Damn it! You're not getting a second copy. Hi.
This is a weak question. I'm seriously interested, so how do I contact you?
If you... visit any porn site, you'll punch my name and you'll find me. Our website's Small Is New Big, and you can get in contact with us through there. Notice that we are a commercial business, but you can also go to the Australian Housing Initiative.com. It's our non-profiting organisation which holds those properties where those women live for $60 a week. You're not at the microphone, you're in trouble. Someone's standing behind there. Thank you for the question.
Okay, so I'm Leslie. So is it possible to come in and have conversation with you on this?
Me personally,
or
no.
Or with your team?
There's a way about of how we actually show people how to do this for themselves as investors. If you're looking for actual properties to live in, then we can sort of branch you out to the olive branches.
No, the investor side.
Yes, we do that. Thank you.
Thank you initially. This is brilliant.
Pleasure.
I was curious about, is there a... With your design with all this, is there an environmental side as far as revegetating areas and when you have this huge group of people?
Sure.
Yep.
Yeah, my ego slide that I didn't put on there is that we've started 26 businesses in the last 25 years. In that is a whole sustainability where I pioneered a three-way partnership between the US, Australia and Canada on studies and education so that people qualified in the three countries if they did that. So sustainability is building that. I also hold 7 worldwide patents for the treatment of wastewater on domestic sites. They cost me about $50,000 a year and I make no money out of them. So good business. Out of all of that, all of the sustainability component is built into our buildings, including solar, including passive design, including green space, and just my own home is a passive earthship built into the hill. It's a modified earthship because I built it out of concrete. I am ethnic, so I don't do rubber, I do concrete. But certainly all our designs make sure that the use of utilities and the use of the space around it is actually bringing people together. As an example, in Tasmania, we have 16 micro apartments built around a central courtyard. Each of them have their own studio space, but they all congregate within the barbecue or kitchen area that's in the courtyard.
Amazing. Can I give you a business idea that someone like you could implement?
Sure.
Taking all these personal trainers, like, obviously.
I live on the coast, yeah.
Yeah. There's PTs everywhere and everyone's getting themselves big and beautiful or
yep.
small and beautiful
mm-hmm.
that they combine a like a land care person, a PT person, an ergonomic body person
yep.
and then took them out instead of doing gym work and getting buff in the mirror, they implemented that energy to reforest places and got to feel good and look
good.
It's
a great way, isn't it? That way that
anyone can have that idea if you want to roll with it.
Sure, awesome. Thank you. Round of applause for that, yeah.
Anyone else want a book? You could just come up and ask Ian if he likes McDonald's. Oh, I knew you
would. She's coming
for the
second book, isn't she?
She does want book
yes.
two.
Yeah.
The sequel.
No, look, I just had a quick question. When you mentioned that word concrete, I just had a quick question.
Yep.
What about hempcrete as opposed to concrete?
Sure, yeah. No, I mean, if at night time I want to smoke a wall, I'll do it. but, like, in the end, if it makes monetary sense, I absolutely will go for it. It's like, and, you know, my apologies to the modular people, container people. We own a modular company, which we don't operate anymore, simply because modular doesn't work. You can't finance them. You need cash up front. Most of them, if you want to build in China, you have to pay them before it leaves China. I sign off on buildings overseas and they get here and they're not the same building that I signed off on. So it has all these problems. So we always talk about, modular being a teenager pretending to be an adult. We're close, but we're not there yet. Hempcrete, if it made monetary sense, it would be put into every building site across the country right now. It's like magnesium oxide board right now is taking over gyprock. Why? Because it makes monetary sense and has a better outcome. Unfortunately, we live in a capitalist society. I agree that building out of hempcrete would be a great thing for the environment. It's just unfortunately people work on finances most of the time. And I'd like to have that balance between you, so I'm with you. But there has to be a balance.
Okay.
Thank you.
You can take the book and give it to somebody.
She's got to give it to your friend. Yep.
Yeah, hi. I'm just curious where you're doing the showground project.
It's overseas.
Oh, okay.
In Tasmania.
Oh.
Last one.
My name's Amy Rose. Can I please have a book?
You're the winner.
Well played.
That's what I'm talking about.
So if you want a copy of the book, all you need to do is just go to our website and plug down to the products and you'll find it on there.
Beautiful. Hey, can you just thank Ian for me? I did tell you that Ian does speak from a deep passion and a deep drive, and you do get the sense of that as he shares. So thanks very much, Ian, for doing that. And